Good morning, church. How are we all doing? What a blessed Easter Sunday this is going to be. It's action-packed. There's baptisms. There's Easter egg hunts. There's baby dedications. There's bouncy castles. There's a lot going on. And I think we're awesomely privileged to get this opportunity, this chance to be in this nation to do exactly this. Now, to kick off our service, we're going to do things slightly differently, but just another piece of housekeeping. If you have your kids with you today, there is no kids' church. Can I have a, oh? But what did I say about bouncy castles? What did I say about Easter egg hunts? What did I say? Well, what I didn't say was there's also an Easter extravaganza game from one of our YAM team as well. So there's enough to sink your teeth into. Hate to use a dad joke. Who's ready to have an excellent Sunday? Oh. But hey, on this excellent Sunday, I just want to remind you what it's all about. It's all about Jesus. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. Guys, turn your attention to the screen and let's have an awesome Sunday.
Yes, Jesus Christ is alive. He rose from the dead, and that day, that Easter Sunday morning, that first Easter, when Mary and Mary Magdalene and Salome went to the grave expecting to anoint a dead body, they saw the angel sitting there. And they said, "Where is Jesus?" The angel said, "He is not here, he is risen." I submit to you tonight that that's the greatest news the world has ever heard. He is not here. He has conquered the grave. He's alive. And ladies and gentlemen, I believe that there's more proof that Jesus Christ rose from the dead than almost any other fact in Roman history. I don't believe there's a fact in ancient history today so well proven as the resurrection of Jesus Christ. But even if there was no proof, no historical proof, no scientific proof, and there is, I would still believe it, because I believe this book is God's inspired word, and the whole early church went up and down the country preaching the resurrection of Jesus Christ. That was the thing that shook the Roman Empire, that a man had risen from the dead, that he was alive, that death could not hold him. Christ is alive. He's a living Savior.
Good morning, church. I just invite you to stand, to stay seated, to lift your hands, to clap, to come down to the front. Use this time as an ultimate time of praise and celebration this morning.
I was buried beneath my shame. Who could care? Thank you. mercy has saved my soul. Now your freedom is all that I know. The old they knew, Jesus, when I met you.
Sing it again.
Now your mercy has saved my soul. Now your freedom is all.
Sing another song that is called The Blood. And I just wanted to read a little bit from scripture for you before we start, just to give you some context as to why we're singing about it. Says in Hebrews, this is Jesus. He said, sacrifices and offerings burnt offerings you did not desire, nor were you pleased with them. This is Jesus talking about the Father. Those were offered in accordance. Here I am. I have come to do your will. Here I am. I have come to do your will, Father. He sets aside the first to establish the second. And by that will, being made holy through the sacrifice of the body of Christ once and for all. For by one sacrifice, he has made perfect forever the being made holy. That's you and me. He is perfect forever. Holy. So we're going to sing about the blood of Jesus, because a perfect sacrifice in our place. Sacrifices that they made before in the Testament, they weren't enough to be a sacrifice for every single person, for the entire world. Only Jesus could do that. Fully God and fully man. Going to sing this song because we believe that he came, he took his burden on the cross, he took every sin on the cross, he took every piece of shame on the cross, he took every rejection on the cross, that he went through that suffering as a sacrifice. He shed his blood for us so that we don't need to make a sacrifice. He is our sacrifice. He raised from the dead. So we're going to sing this song because that is what we believe. Everything changed as you recognize the purpose before I don't walk like I used to. I've been washed from the inside. The person I was, down to Christ. And I don't walk. I've been washed from the inside. I've been washed from the inside out. Hallelujah, hallelujah. I know it was. It could have only been the blood. Hallelujah, hallelujah. I know it was the blood. It could have only been the blood. Yeah. Oh, we thank you. Not but nothing's more real than this of God. Oh, when my heart experienced, and when my shame hit the wayside, and met the Most High, I've been washed from the inside. Blood, it could have only been the blood. Hallelujah, hallelujah. I know it was the blood, it could have only been the blood. Could have only been your blood. done in righteousness because of you, Jesus. We thank you that we get to come before the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. That when he looks at us, that he doesn't see sin, but he sees his Son. Jesus, we thank you that you went to the cross, but that you also raised from the grave. That you are God who is alive. That you are our God who is our present help. Lord, we thank you that no other king would have done that. No other king would have left his throne in heaven to come to earth as a baby, to then take the weight of the sin of the world, to then rise from the dead and to be seated at the right hand of the Father. So Jesus, we exalt you. You are holy. You are holy, holy, holy.
Song shall
encourage you to use this moment to lift up your own voice with your thanksgiving before God this morning, with your adoration, with your love. If you don't know what else to say, you can just say, "You are worthy, God. I recognize that you are worthy, Lord. You are holy, Lord."
People of God, the Spirit of God is here, and this is a holy moment. If you want more from God, do you know this is our choice to reach out to God and say, "God, I want more of you." I think we should go into a time of just, if you speak in the heavenly language of tongues, why don't you just use that right now? If you just want to sing out in English, you sing out in English. You do whatever is right for you, but you know the Spirit and the presence of God is here. And I don't want us to leave this morning without actually knowing a touch of the Holy Spirit, because God has got so much for us. These words are powerful. Holy, holy. You may be comfortable to close your eyes, but today we have come to worship the risen King. The risen King. Raise your voices. Holy. To this God that we're singing about, can I tell you something about him? Every other religious leader is still dead. Only Jesus, the Savior, has ever died, but has the only one that has ever risen again to conquer death. That is the God that we're worshiping here this morning. Why don't you just ask God for a touch of him? If you feel comfortable, you can raise your hands. If you don't, that's okay. But the presence of God is here, and he wants to talk to every one of his children. There's no child above another. We are all God's children, and he wants to touch who you are and where you are at this morning. Why don't you just say, "God, I want to know your presence around me. I want to hear your voice speak to me." Because the Holy Spirit is here, and he will touch us all in completely different ways. There's times where you will just feel a fluttering in your eyelids. Sometimes you just feel a weakness in your knees. Sometimes you just feel like a presence on your shoulders. But the presence of God wants to tell you that he is here. You may say, "Fiona, this is a little weird." It's also a little good. A lot good. God is real. If you feel like you haven't been close to him for a long time, just say, "God, I just want to know that you're with me. I don't really know what's going on, but I just want to know that your presence is around me." Because I'm here in church today. Somehow I don't really know how I even got here, but I don't want to leave here without having met with the risen King Jesus. Keep singing that.
Our song.
risen King, I've seen it in majesty. You are the risen King. Can we sing Our God is Alive?
Singing hallelujah, he won the victory for us. Do you know at that cross, for all the prophecies that were spoken in the New Testament, over 300 of them of the coming King, it was validated at the cross and by the resurrection life of Jesus Christ. And I want to speak over you, for every promise that was given to you as a child, every promise that was given to you, every prophecy has been validated at the cross and by the blood of Jesus Christ. That is who we are in Him. Could you, I'm going to ask you some questions. For all those of you who know about the risen life of Jesus and the effects on your life, hands up here if you have lived and walked through and been healed from cancer. Look around. This is a resurrected life. Jesus is alive. Jesus is alive. Hands up whoever have been healed by Jesus in the past. Look at these hands. Say after me, Jesus is alive. Jesus is my healer. Who knows that Jesus has freed them from anxiety? Jesus is alive. Who here knows that Jesus has actually given them freedom in their lives to walk with Him and to believe that He is the King of Kings? Jesus is alive. Do you know the people's testimony are so powerful? You overcome by the blood of the Lamb and by the... And where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is... There's freedom in this house, people. If you want to know who Jesus is, today is your day. We are, this is a big day for us because we celebrate the risen Christ. We are also celebrating people who want to get baptized. We're also celebrating a baby dedication. There's so much going on. But I also recognize that throughout all our celebration, there's also pain that's going on in people's lives. Do you know, the thief comes to steal, kill, and destroy, but it is Jesus who comes to give us life and to give us life to the full. For all the pain that we're going through, Jesus says He will never leave us nor forsake us. He will walk right there with us. I don't want to negate pain that's what people are going through, but what I want to put our focus on this morning is the power of the resurrection life of Jesus Christ, who will walk through it with us and will give you His life, His truth. Do we don't walk in our truth, we walk in the truth of who Jesus is, because Jesus is the way. He is, come on, speak with me. Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. Jesus, wherever there has been mistruth have landed in our lives, I ask, Lord, You would expose it and that we would know Your truth in all that we do and all that we say. We ask in the name of Jesus. Amen. All God's people said, I'm not sure I heard that. All God's people said, thank You, God, for Your presence in this place. Thank You, God, for Your resurrected life that lives in every one of us. Thank You, God, for the power and the gift of Jesus. You loved us so much that You gave Your Son, Jesus, that whoever may believe will have everlasting life. If you don't believe in Jesus this morning, I want to give you an opportunity now. If you want to say yes to Jesus, all you need to do is to say, sorry, Jesus, for my sins. I want to have that life that that woman up on that stage is talking about. I want to know a freedom from pain and from sin in my life, and I want to invite You into my life in Jesus' name. And see, throughout this service, I want you just to be aware of the Holy Spirit that's around you, because He's going to be just tapping on your shoulder and saying, hey, I'm here. Hey, I'm here. Do we've coming into this point of our service where we give people the opportunity to give of their offerings and their tithes. I know a lot of you give online. We actually have a QR code if you'd like to give online. So many give online, and we are so grateful for the giving that you give into this house. We give because God first gave to us His Son. That is His heart towards you. His nature, His heart, is always to be generous towards us. It is a heart of love. So when we give of our tithes and our offerings, and we have baskets at the front here that you are welcome. In fact, one of the baskets aren't here. Maybe the host could find the other basket. Well, it's actually meant to be in the front seat there. Mr. Glenn, Would you mind getting that wee basket? Or Will's got it. And for the rest of you, I want you to take this opportunity to turn around to the people who are round about you. Just introduce yourself and say, I wish I was sitting beside the other person, but I'm actually beside you. Just say hi, introduce yourself. We're just going to take a moment, because after this, we're going to ask Mr. Ben to come up, and he's going to do the next part of the service. Thank you.
Something bigger than me, 'cause I've seen in a hospital room when the doctor said sorry, there's nothing more we can do. Well, it wasn't through. I've never seen a pot of gold at the end of the rainbow, but I've got a promise I can hold in the middle of the struggle. God, if you said you'll perform, it may not be how I want you to, but here's what I'll do. I'm gonna wait on you. I'm gonna wait on you. I've tasted your goodness. I'm trusting your promise. I'm gonna wait on you. Yes, I'm gonna wait. I've tasted your goodness. I'm trusting your promise. I'm gonna wait on you. Yes, I will. Yes, I will. And all the questions, they come second to the one I know is true, yeah. Well, you've always been true, so I'm gonna wait on you. Yeah. I'm gonna wait on you.
All right then, you lot. Right, I need your attention on this one. I've got something for you. It's not just my suit, and I've showered and everything for you. I'm proper treating you. I know I'm dressed like a 75-year-old, but if you don't know me, my name is Ben, and I promise you I am the youth worker, and I don't dress like this ever. So this is a real treat for you. But as a youth worker, on a Friday night, we have what we like to call Christ-centered chaos. That is tribe. And we thought, being Easter, having all of the services, all of the three and the seven with us in-house here this morning, I thought we'd bring some of that Christ-centered chaos to you, if that's all right. Now, as you can see, I've got completely irrelevant to Easter items in my hand. I tried to get egg-shaped, but they just wouldn't do it. So what we try and do at Tribe, what we always do at Tribe, is it's full of games, it's full of all this chaos I'm telling you about. But what the Tribe members may even never notice is that all of our games are always relevant to the theme of that week. So we've just finished off doing like the fruits of the spirit, right? So we did patience a few weeks ago, and you know that game where, and I don't know how many of you there might be, but you kind of cross your arms and hold someone's arm or hold someone's hand, and you kind of make yourself into a knot, and then you say go, and you have to untie yourself. Do you know what I mean? And you kind of flip over someone's arm, climb over that child, kick that one out the way. Now that's Christ-centered chaos. So that was patience, right? Because most of the boys will have enough and they'll get sweaty palms, or they'll be having to hold a girl's hand and it's all embarrassing. So we're trying to teach them patience, right? So speaking of themed games, this has no theme, I'm sorry. I was really trying to get an Easter theme. Long story short, I failed. But we're just going to have some Christ-centered chaos. So kids, I need you big time. Tribe members especially. I've got one of these balls each. We've got maybe 30 seconds. We'll do a couple rounds. And as you're kind of in categories, in your areas already,
you're the team, right? This middle one's looking a bit too powerful, but you're going to have one of these each, and you got a minute to get rid of it, basically, and dump it on someone else, okay? Is that all right? All right, cool. We're going to see what happens. Christ-centered chaos, remember? Oh, yeah. Nice. Craig. Oh, gosh. Right. We might have some tunes in the background. I'm going to have a minute on my timer, and you just send it. If you're feeling brave, just send it into the balcony. Then they're stuffed. All right? Right, a minute, starting in 3, 2, 1, go. Woohoo! Oh, we got headshots going on. Go on, Dad. Flipping, eh? Nice. Weaves are going flying. Will, between your legs, lad. Go on, Richard. Yeah. Three. Oh, Will, Megs, go on. 20 seconds. Quick, get it gone. 7 seconds. 3, 2, 1. It's up, it's over. God, you cheater. Oh, but the middle, I think you're hiding a couple in there, aren't you? Where are they? Go on, own up. Where are the balls? Yeah, I see. Yeah. Oh, well. You lot in the middle, you were looking strong at the start, but you've got 3 going. Heather, I see you. You cheater. The game's over. Should we go again? All right. I saw a few headshots in there. Womba has got a black eye coming already, so let's calm it down a bit. All right? Richard, I think that was you going for that one. Right, guys. I'm going to start another minute, and you're going to see what you can do. 3, 2, 1, go. Guys, there's one there. Gotcha! Go on, Fiamma, get it gone. Yeah, nice. Yeah! Hey, what a cat! Hey! Quick. What we got? 18 seconds. Oh, on the head. Ooh, it's getting aggressive. 7 seconds. Quick. 3, 2, 1. Hey. Now, there you go. That's a bit of Christ-centered chaos for you right there. I'm going to pass over to Gordon. Where are you?
Let's give it up for Elvis Presley. This morning we have a baby dedication. Are you ready? Let's give it up for Will and Charlotte. She'll be here in a minute. And where's Luke? Here he is here. And Richard, are you going to join me as well to pray? That's good. Come and stand over here, guys, in the middle. Hi. So this is Will. This is Charlotte. This is, what's your name?
Luke.
And what's my name?
Gordon.
He's getting my cream egg at the end of the meeting. No bribery involved at all. Let's just stand back. Good morning to everybody in the balcony. Nice to see you guys. Are you ready for the dedication? Yeah, a wee nod from everybody in the balcony. It's good. So we're going to pray with little Noah. How old is Noah now? Is it 3? 5 months, not 3 months, 5 months. A typical man. All the women are going like, typical man, doesn't know. Just no clue. So in a moment, we're gonna pray with Noah, but I'm just going to share a couple of words with you. The Bible says that children are a heritage from Yahweh or from God. So this is a heritage, and it talks about how your quiver will be full of them. So your quiver is getting fuller and fuller. Also says that in Matthew 19, when the children were brought by the disciples, they rebuked and told the children off, but Jesus brought the children to them and blessed them. So this morning, this is an act like Jesus. We're going to bless this child in Jesus' name. But before we pray, I'm going to give you four peas in a pod. Are you ready? So this is a little mini sermonette for you guys. Don't worry, it'll only last about 3 minutes. Number one is prayer. So for your child, for your children, when you raise a family, number one, P, is the power of prayer. Remember and pray for your children every day. Lay hands on them. Pray for them. At times it might be in absolute holiness. Other times it might be complete frustration. But whatever you do, just pray. Number two is position them for purpose. In other words, you need to have the belief that you can position them and have faith that they'll do great things for God and great things in life. So position them for purpose. The third P is prophesy. Prophesy over your children. Will and Charlotte, as a priest and priestess in your household, you're also a prophet and a prophetess. And prophesy over your children. Get the word and prophesy over your children. Number four, the kids will love this one, is play. Remember and play with your children. Hands up who remember spending all the gifts you got on Christmas Day or your birthdays from your parents. I can't remember any, but I remember the time I spent. And if you spend time in play, so play time. Go for a walk, or go for a drive, do something, but have fun with your children in Jesus' name. So in a moment, we're going to pray for Noah, and we're going to dedicate him unto the Lord and say, Lord, bless this child in Jesus' name. And I'm going to invite Richard, who's a friend of the family and a small group leader, a pastoral leader with his family, and he's going to pray over Noah, then I'm going to pray for you as parents as well. Is that okay? Listen, are we in agreement as we pray this morning? Can we all stand to our feet and we're going to pray for them as a family here this morning, Richard?
Father God, we just take a moment to thank you for this precious, precious family. Thank you for Will and Charlotte. Thank you for Luke. And we thank you for Noah. And Father, we remember that Noah in the Bible was a man who heard from God. He was a man who believed and who obeyed. He was a man of commitment, a man of faithfulness. And Father, we pray for these things for little Noah, that these would be characteristics of Noah. Sorry, he's smiling at me. I just, it's wrecking me. Father God, I just thank you for Noah. Thank you for his smiles. And we just pray your joy of the Holy Spirit would fill his soul right from now, right through his whole life, that he would come to know Jesus in his early years, and he would walk with Jesus, and he would be a man who listens to God, hears from God, and faithfully follows. So we pray your blessing on Noah. We pray, Father, this morning you'll fill him even now with your Holy Spirit, and you'll watch over him and his family in Jesus' name. Amen.
And let's just pray over you as a couple as well. Father, we thank you for Will and Charlotte, as parents, that you would bless them. The Bible says that if you lack wisdom, to ask God, and he will give it in abundance. So I pray that they would be the askers of wisdom on a daily basis as they raise these two beautiful little boys. Give them your divine wisdom. Give them your favor. And Father, we pray that your divine doors will open to them as a family. Thank you for your favor upon them. We thank you that Jesus grew in favor, in wisdom and stature, and had favor with both God and man. And we thank you that's on Will and Charlotte, your divine favor from you, but also from people as well. We also pray for the extended family as well. We pray for the relatives, the grandparents that are here today, that you would bless them, give them wisdom as they input into these little boys' lives. We pray that, O God, in Jesus' name. And all God's people said, amen. Please take your seats. Let's give this couple a big shout. Clap. Clap, clap. Thank you.
And we all say, Okay, we have come to the time of our service where we are doing baptisms, and we have four baptisms. So can I welcome on stage Zoe, Mariam, Candace, and who's my other one? Georgia. Sorry, Georgia. Come on, come up on stage. Please do. Come up, come up. And we're going to stand back here while the guys take off the cover of the baptism pool. Do you know, if you know someone who's getting baptized here, you are welcome to go upstairs to have a look or come round the pool to have a look. But we have asked, come on guys, come stand beside me. Zoe, come stand beside me. I'm ready to have a wee dive. It's actually a jacuzzi. We hired this out as a jacuzzi during the week. I'm kidding. It's pretty good though. Is it warm? That's what I want to know. Is it warm? Okay, come forward a wee bitty. Come forward. So everybody can see your, come on, Mariam, come forward. So everybody can see your gorgeous looking faces. Okay, I heard their testimonies this week and I was like, whoa-zers. And I said to them, do not miss a word out of all that you have just said. So Mariam, can you tell everybody, first of all, tell them who you are, what age you are, if you're allowed to, if you're single or married, and I'm only joking. And how you came to know Jesus.
Hi everyone, my name is Mariam. I'm from Nigeria, studying nursing, and I came to know Jesus through a friend, actually. So I was born and raised as a Muslim, and so I converted when I came to Scotland. So the conversion was basically like, I was like going through a phase in life and a friend prayed for me and it literally felt like a hug from God. And she invited me to church. I went to church and never looked back.
The power of invitation. Mariam, can I ask you, what difference has it made in your life following Jesus?
The major difference is intimacy. In my previous religion, I never felt like I was close to God. Ever since I converted, I can hear God's voice, I can hear him speak to me, I can hear God encourage me. And it's just been very beautiful. He has revealed places of my life, an aspect I need to work on as well. And so ever since I encountered Jesus, my life definitely changed.
Can you give us a little bit more? It's powerful. It really is powerful. Joe, there's a number of people in this church who grew up as Muslims, and they've had visitations, encounters with Jesus or with angels during the night, and that's how they've come to know and walk with Jesus today. Can you tell us, how is it? What was your first encounter with Jesus like?
So I would say my first ever encounter was when I was praying with that friend. And so like I said, I was going through a very difficult phase. And so she prayed for me and she literally revealed everything I was going through. I was very shocked. And so then when we were praying, it felt like God was giving me a very big hug, like an encouragement to push further. And that was what I needed at that time. So I would say that was my first ever encounter. Ever since I encountered God, I have had subsequent encounters with him as well.
Wow. If you need a hug from God this morning, why don't you ask him, God, could you hug me? That is powerful. Thank you, Mariam. I'm going to ask if I can come between you. Okay, Candace. Can you tell us your age and how you came to know Jesus? And don't miss anything out that you told me on Wednesday night.
I'm Candace and I'm 15 years old. And personally, I was like, I've always known Jesus because I was raised in a Christian family with like the healthy habits of like praying every night, you know, praying in the morning. So like that just made, at a young age, I knew that God was real and like I knew him.
Tell us about your prayer warrior group.
Oh, and I went to a Christian boarding school, and we had a group called the Prayer Warriors. We would, like, pray every morning before school, and during that prayer session, you'd feel so, like, at home and at ease, and you just feel so safe. And that's when I was like, God is real. And it was, like, that feeling, like, when you know it, you know?
Candace, are you going to pray for all those who are in school right now, all the secondary school ones or even the primary school ones? Will you just do me a really quick prayer to pray that what you had going into school would be over these guys too?
Okay. Oh, dear Heavenly Father, I pray for everyone that is going to school. I pray that they do not lose their hope and that they should keep pushing through. I pray that they may not be influenced because this world has a lot of bad things, especially if you're young. You just have to learn to keep trusting God, and I pray for everyone. Amen.
Amen, amen, amen. It's getting better and better. Okay, woman, go and tell us who you are, what's your name, and how did you come to know Jesus?
I'm Georgia, I'm 21, and I came to know Jesus probably like past year. And a couple Sundays ago, I kind of shared my testimony, and I won't share it again because it's not PG-13, but I wrote a little things just to remind me. But basically my testimony kind of revolved around not like knowing, finding God when I didn't know that he was doing stuff when I didn't know him, sort of thing, and that like how much he's influenced me when I didn't even know it. And so I kind of just wanted to stop letting things that I'd gone through determine where I was kind of going and wanting to start a new life, sort of thing. And it's been great, and like my healing journey has been like on the express train since. But basically I came to church, I came to Gate with my partner to see what it was all about, and then ended up kind of just being like, oh, puzzle pieces, they're all falling into place. And then I just started to slowly wanting to learn more and more and more, and then it made sense. And then I told him that I was like, yeah, this makes sense, I'm Christian, sort of thing. And basically finding, when I moved away to a new city, I was like, it was really rural where I lived, and I wanted a community that I felt in the past, so now this is like the perfect place, and I've been involved in the community. But now that I feel like I'm the one encouraging other people to come to church and like inviting more people, and it's just what I want. But after finding faith, it's just kind of been a real change in me. Like everyone's kind of noticed it and said something like, well, you're a different person now. And my sister, she's just behind me, told me that like she's seen my happiness grow, and like it's just that felt so good that that he's good even though she doesn't believe, but like the good he's done in me and others around me is just the perfect thing. But it's really a freedom that I've never felt, and it's just pouring out of love from everyone who's around me and everyone who heard it. Yeah.
And why do you want to get baptized?
I think for me, again, to do with my testimony, it's just like everything's shed away and starting my new walk and being quite bold, because I'm quite nervous about sharing my faith, but it's that boldness, I think. Yeah.
In baptism, we die to our old life and we rise up again with the life of Jesus to say, we want to do God's will, not our will. That's basically it. Okay, Mrs. Zoe, thank you so much. Mrs. Zoe. Do you want to share what you've got to the people? Do you want to tell us why you're getting baptized today?
I want to follow God, and this is a really great way to represent that I want to really commit to him, and I want this to be like it's an official thing.
Zoe told me through there, she said that she knows that God loves her and she wants to take this step as an obedient step before God to say, I want to grow in you. Do you want to add any more? Or do you just want to shout amen, Fiona? Amen, Fiona. Do you know, well done, Zoe. Do you know, you guys are scary out there. Can I just tell you, you're all scary. When you're standing up here and looking out and talking, it's scary. So well done, Zoe. Okay, we have Wamba and we have Ben who have come to be baptized. We are going to baptize them one by one. The worship team are going to be, boy, you've got changed, mate. What happened to your suit? The worship team are going to play a song of worship. You can join in. You can come up here and see it. It's up to you. We just want this to be a time of celebration. So over to the band, please. Thank you. Oh, go for it.
And I also want to say for all my, like, all the teenage girls, all the teenage boys, that you should remember if God is for you, nothing can be against you, and nothing is greater than God. And you should all remember that.
Amen. Go for it, women. Go for it. You're the only one who can. Let's sing that again.
Jesus' name into glory. You're the only one who can. You turn graves into gardens. You turn bones into armies. You turn seas into highways. You're the only one. Let's sing that again. You turn graves. You turn graves into gardens.
Jesus, come on, he is King. Guys, you can hang out with me here just now. I'm not joining the band, I'm just going to do a 5-minute talk. Then we're going to sing music. You guys can have a seat just now. You can sit down upstairs as well. I know the sound took time to get up there. But it's good to see you all here this morning. Who's heard the phrase, he is risen? He's risen indeed. There's a famous Soviet atheistic preacher in the 1930s who had a crowd in front of him, and he preached and berated and belittled Christianity, belittled Jesus, and there was thousands of people in this audience, and he just mocked Christ. And he looked around and he said, after an hour of pontificating all this craziness, he said, has anybody here got anything to say? And this little priest shuffled up to the stage, stood on the stage, and said, he is risen. And everyone in the auditorium stood to their feet and said, he is risen indeed. And in 1 second, he demolished an hour's worth of argument. You see, the man who was the Soviet preacher, the atheist preacher, was preaching to the mind, and he'd almost convinced people. But the priest preached to the heart. And there's something powerful about understanding the heart and the mind. Jesus said, he summarized the two commandments powerfully. When the Pharisees, in between the time, Hosanna, Hosanna to the King of Kings, his entrance into the Jerusalem that we preached on last week, there were 7 woes, and he addressed the Pharisees, and they tried to trip Jesus up. And one of the questions they asked them was, what's the greatest of the commandments? There was 10 commandments, 4 towards God, 6 towards man. So he said, what's the greatest? And Jesus, masterclass, and in an executive summary, Jesus said that can be summarized in 2. He said, love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your soul, all your mind, and all your strength. In other words, love him holistically. And he went on to say, love thy neighbor as thyself as well. So he summarized them powerfully. But in ancient Hebrew culture, the seat of the soul is the heart. The heart is the seat of the soul. In Greek culture, the mind is the seat of the soul. So when you go back through ancient times, people respected the power of a man or a woman's heart, how God had to engage the heart. When you go through the Pauline teachings, the teachings of the Apostle Paul, he reaches a Greek culture. So when you read his epistles, it's all about mind renewal. So he understands the difference between the heart and the mind. But today, we're preaching to the hearts and the minds of the believers. Come on. So there's something powerful about the Word of God. So God loves us. He doesn't just love our minds. He loves our hearts, our minds, our souls, a body's a spirit. He loves everything about us. You see, the Word of God is powerful. It can appeal to the intellect, but it also appeals to the heart. And the Spirit of God grabs people by the heart. Can I give you an example? Well, I don't need to ask your permission. I'm going to do it anyway. So it was a friend of mine who was in his late 50s. This is going back nearly 20 years ago. And his dad was dying. And his dad was in his 80s. And he was a hard man. And he was hard against his son. He was hard against God. He was an atheist, hated the church. And the son went on and on about his dad and how much he hated him and hated the church. But he said, look, would you go and see him? I said, aye, sure, because I'm kind of up for a wee challenge now and again. So I said, yeah, no problems. I'll come in and see him. So I threw the son out the room because I could smell his unbelief. Even though he believed in Jesus, I'm like, mate, you're out the room. I'm speaking to your dad on my own. So I did. And I spoke to the dad and I said, look, you know why I'm here today. You know what I do. I'm a pastor of a church. But I'm here to appeal to something in your heart. Can I explain it? And he gave me permission. I said, listen, there's billions of little cells in your heart and inside your body. I said, is it possible that there's one little cell in your body that might think there is a God? And he said, well, maybe there could be one cell. I said, can I preach to that cell? And he said, yes. I said, I'm going to preach to that cell, and I'm going to pray that cell multiplies. So I said, can you give me 5 minutes? So I explained the gospel to him in 5 minutes. And at the end of it, he was crying, and he was in tears. And he said, he was just crying out to God. He prayed a prayer with me to receive Jesus, the Messiah. And it was so powerful. The son in his 50s, I said, you need to come back in the room. And the son in his 50s nearly had a heart attack. Because his dad, who'd been an ardent atheist all his life, went, praise the Lord, son, hallelujah, in this big booming voice. And I had to pick the guy off the ground. And he struggled to believe that his dad had truly come to faith. But I want to tell you, the Word is powerful. And whether you're at early days, like the young person who's 15 coming to faith in Christ, or whether you're end of days, Jesus has risen. He has risen indeed. I want us to pray this morning for, I've got this thing over me this morning called cancer tension, okay? Because we're going to pray for somebody in a minute. Somebody phoned me, where's George? George phoned me during the week, and he phoned me and said, I've got some good news, I'm cancer free. Come on. And that was his doctor that phoned him and said, I've got some good news. I had another phone call by a man. Where's John? John, give me a wave. John's at the back. John has come to faith in Christ recently. And John was diagnosed. He's had cancer quite a few years. But he was basically told that he'd be gone about 4 weeks ago. But he's here this morning. And John needs a miracle. However, George and Pauline and some of the people around John, can you lay hands on John? Because he's still got cancer in his body, and he needs a miracle. And John is at peace with himself. He's made his peace with God. And he knows that if he dies, he goes to heaven. If he stays and gets healed, praise God. So can I invite us all to stand, and we're going to pray for John here this morning. Is that okay? Heavenly Father, we thank you for this man of God. He's just recently come to know you. And Father, as the people around him lay hands on him, we just declare your peace, your presence, your power, your purpose. And Father God, we just thank you that you love him. And we just pray, oh God, that you would touch him. Bring your healing touch to this man's soul. Thank you that he's received salvation. But God, we pray for a miracle against all odds. Nothing is impossible to you, and nothing is impossible to those who believe. We pray that, oh God. Spirit of God, just touch him. Anybody else here this morning, if you need a miracle in your body, just do this with your hand. Just lift your hand up. We're going to pray. Just pray for the people round about you. Just lift your hand high. Just be bold and say, I need a healing in my body. Just lay hands on the people round about you. Just, Father God, we just cry out to you this morning. We thank you that you're a miracle-working God. And thank you for all the hands that were raised this morning because they'd known your healing touch. And, Father, we pray, oh God, we thank you that so many come to know you because they get healed. And Father, we pray this morning for that miracle in people's bodies, in people's minds. We pray that, oh God, in Jesus' name. And all God's people said? Amen. And John was really kind to me. So I mentioned Ben looking like Elvis earlier. I've got a secret. It's not going to be a secret anymore, but I'm an Elvis fan. And John gave me one of his albums. He said, I want to give you a gift. It's a 1957 Elvis gospel album. So I'm now in possession of that, unless somebody's nicked it off the front row. So, amen. So we're going to finish this morning. In a moment, we're going to finish. But we're going to sing one more song of worship. And after that, Fiona, you need to help me, because tell me what's happening at the end once the worship's finished.
Afterwards, we have a bouncy castle for the kids, which is through in the other room. It is unsupervised, but it's not outside, so it won't fly away. So please know where your children are. We have eggs all around the church inside the building here now in the foyer, but they're not upstairs. So for an Easter egg hunt. We also are going to have lunch all together. So there will be silver platters coming around full of food that have been homemade, especially for you guys. We want to say thank you to Margaret and to Joy, who have made all the food today. So one last song of worship, and then we will come to a close. Thank you.
Hey guys, we're going to sing this song called Praise. We like a good celebration here at the gate. So we're going to celebrate together. And we're going to celebrate. Can you hear me now? Kind of hear me now? Do you want more of me? More of me. Need to hear me more? Hello, hello, hello. Hey. I was just saying that we love a good celebration here at the gate. So that's what we're going to do to finish out this Easter Sunday service, is we're going to celebrate. There's plenty of room down here at the front. You've got full permission to move and groove and raise your hands and shout and sing. And if your praise is just like a little two-step, then that's awesome. Do that. But we're going to celebrate everything that God has done. And we're celebrating as if every single person in the room who said, I need healed, has come back and has said, I'm healed. Are you ready?
I'll praise in the valley. I'll praise on the mountain. I'll praise when I'm sure. And praise when I'm down. I'll praise when outnumbered, and praise when surrounded. Cause praise is the water my enemies drown in. As long as I'm breathing, I've got a reason to praise the Lord, oh my soul. I'll praise 'cause I know you're still in control. 'Cause my praise is a weapon, it's more than a sound. My praise is the shout that brings Jericho down. As long as I'm breathing, I've got a reason to praise the Lord, oh my soul.
Praise!
Praise the Lord, oh my soul.
And praise!
Oh my soul. And praise 'cause you're sovereign. Praise 'cause you rose and defeated the grave. I'll praise 'cause you're faithful. Praise 'cause you're true. Praise 'cause there's nobody greater than you. I'll praise 'cause you rose and defeated the grave.
I'll praise 'cause you're sovereign.
I'll praise 'cause you're sovereign. Praise 'cause you reign. Praise 'cause you rose and defeated the grave. I'll praise 'cause you're faithful.
Praise 'cause you're true.
Praise 'cause there's nobody greater than you.
Down there, George's mom said she's not been able to hear music before. Her ears have been open and she can hear music. Do you know, God actually said to me at the start of this service, I will open deaf ears. So is there anybody here, anybody else who is deaf? Because I'm going to go on this word God gave to me at the start, and I actually forgot about it until you came up and said that her ears have been opened. Is there anybody else here who has a deaf ear? See those who've got their hands up. I want you just to put those who are around them. Go and put your hand on their ears. Go and put your hand on their ears. Father, we thank you, God, that every spirit of deafness be gone in Jesus' name. And that we stand on the resurrective life of Jesus Christ that says, ears be open in the name of Jesus. Hear, be open in Jesus' name. We thank you, God, that they will go back to how you created them to be, to hear the voice of God, to have ears that are open, to have ears that hear your voice, but also hear in the physical as well as in the natural. Father, we thank you for your healing. We thank you for your restoration in the name of Jesus. And by the stripes of Jesus, you are healed in the name of Jesus. And all God's people said, amen. Amen. Now let's put it to the test. Let's put it to the test. All those who got prayed with, I want you to say, can you hear any better in the other ear? Can you hear any other? Can you hear any better? Put your hand up if you can hear any better. Can you? Okay, let's get back to praying again, because we're not going to leave here until there's some healing. Are you saying yes? Can you hear better? Okay, how much? Out of 10, how much? 5, 4. Out of 10, how much can you hear? 5 out of 10. Okay, let's keep on praying, people. Let's raise our faith levels. You pray as well. If you believe in Jesus, Jesus is a healer. And we say to your deaf ears, be open in the name of Jesus. Every spirit of infirmity that has come against you, we command it to go now in Jesus' name. And we thank you, God, that you are our healer. You are our restorer. And Father, we command these ears to be open now in Jesus' name. Be open. Hear the voice of God. Hear music. Hear people speak. You will no longer be isolated, but you will be involved in community in Jesus' name. Okay, now test it again. Tell me, is your ears healed? Test it again. Do you feel any better? Do you hear any better? Any better? I'm still talking. Any better? Can you hear better? Jason? Can you hear? Are you getting any better? Any better?
come on. I don't want to give up because I want to see God healed. God, give me a word. I believe it's to be true. I believe it's going to be healed. Jason, tell me, are you hearing any better? Thank you, Jesus, he is. Thank you, Jesus, he is. Joe, we need to come to an end because the kids have done fantastic this morning. Thank you, kids, for being so patient with all of us. Listen, may God bless you this week. May God keep you this week. May you know the face of God to shine upon you this week. May God be gracious to you this week. And may you know God's peace in everything that you do. I'm going to say it one more time. He is risen. Thank you for coming to church today. We're all going to have some lunch. Kids can go through there for the bouncy castle and the Easter egg hunt. Let it commence. Thank you for coming to church.
On stages, I even love it when the crowd gets loud, singing out God's praises. But every now and then, it can get a little complicated. So I remember when I was in that old church basement, singing hallelujah. It's all I need when I think of your goodness. Your love for me, oh, the joy of my salvation is coming back to me. It's just in, oh, hallelujah, with a new melody, and I'm singing, oh, oh. Got together every Wednesday night, about 30 teenagers. My friend Josh bought a cheap guitar and barely knew how to play it. He wasn't putting on a show, wasn't well known, wasn't trying to be famous. But we sure touched heaven in that old church basement. Hallelujah. Thank you.